না আসলে ওর প্রশ্ন চায় না অন্য কেউ শুনুক। ঠিক আছে শুরু হয়ে গেছে। সো হি সেড ইউ শুড স্লোলি চ্যান্ট হরিনাম অ্যান্ড স্লোলি চ্যান্ট হরিনাম উইথ প্রপার প্রোনাউন্সিয়েশন, ডোন্ট চ্যান্ট মিনস ভেরি ফাস্ট। He said, what else you want to know? আর কিছু নেই। ওকে ওকে হরে কৃষ্ণা। হ্যাঁ বলুন মহারাজ, কি বলবেন? সাধু সঙ্গ বলেছিলেন।
হে কৃষ্ণ কর্ণা সিন্ধ দীনবন্ধ জগৎপতি গোপীশ গোপিকা কান্ত রাধা কান্ত নমস্তুতে তপ্ত কাঞ্চন গৌরাঙ্গী রাধে বৃন্দাবনেশ্বরি বিষভানুসুতে দেবী প্রণমামি বন্দে নন্দব্রজশ্রীনাম পাদুরেণুম অভিজ্ঞেশ ব্যাসাম হরিকথতে গীতম শুনাতি ভুবনত্রয়ম। নারায়ণ নমস্কৃতম নরং চৈব নরোত্তমম দেবীং সরস্বতীং ব্যাসম ততো জয়মতি রয়ে।
I hope the sound is okay, everyone can hear.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Sarvagri, Param, Hare Jokam, Silo, Guru, Patami, Satsangha, Dalvatam, Sahai, Tarotis, Mohi, Sukhi, Kripa, Bhakti,
So today Maharaj is going to speak on Sadhu Sangha, association of devotees. So we are always getting disturbed by this material heat of this world, adhyatmik, adidevik and adibhautik. So that's why in always it has been so there are two prayers of Nisingadev we always have to chant, because when we will chant these two lines of the prayers of Nrisingadev, what will happen? It will protect us from our path of devotion. Any danger comes, we will get protected. So it doesn't you can chant this mantra in the morning or also in the night, and that is called kavach. Kavach means a protection. So people's you can see nowadays people wears that kavacha by writing that mantra and put it inside that, and they wear it in their body. Ugram viram mahavishnu jalantam sarvatan mukha nishingha vishanam bhadra mrityur mrityun namam miham ugro grevayam sabhaktanan nikishori
নিশাম বিক্রমঃ প্রহ্লাদ হৃদয়হ্লাদম ভক্তিবীদ বিরাম শরদিন্দুরুচিং বন্দে পারিন্দবদনম হরিম তব করকমলবরে নখয়াদ্ভূতসিংহম দলিতহিরণ্যকশিপুতনুভৃঙ্গম কেশবধৃত নরহরিরূপম জয় জগদীশ হরে। ওম জয় জগদীশ হরে। ওম
So this is the mantra which Maharaj chanted just now. He said, it's not necessary to wear kavach, but in the morning or in the evening, with sincerity, you can remember Nrisimhadev and can chant this mantra. Because what is happening when we are trying to perform devotion, that time we are getting disturbed by the material heats of this world, of adhyatmik, adidaivik and adibhautik. So these are the hindrances in the path of devotion, because Maya tries to destroy the bhakti which we want to do. So these obstructions in the path of devotion can be removed by the grace of Nrisimhadev. So that's why you should always remember Nrisimhadev and should chant this mantra for protection of your bhakti. And So we were discussing about Sadhu Sangha, association of devote sadhus. So who can be called Sadhu? Kapil Dev and Devahuti. So Kapil Dev is the empowered soul of Supreme Lord. In the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Kapil Dev is telling instructions to Mother Devahuti. Means he will go for meditation, and before going, he is giving some instructions to his mother. That as the mother is asking to son, to Kapil Dev, as I am in the community of women, and now I am attached to the materialistic world, and I don't know by taking which path I can be successful in my devotion. I can get perfection in my devotion rather. And then Maharaj is telling that there were many other limbs of devotion, like Gyan Marga, Bhakti Marga, and many other different things. There are many ways to reach Supreme Lord. So Kapil Dev here, Mother Devahuti here asked to Kapil Dev, by taking which limb of devotion I will get perfection. So Kapil Dev replied to her first question that one can get the mercy of Supreme Lord only by the association of devotees. So in every scriptures it is written that the association of sadhus is so important. Even a one second of association with the sadhu can just change your life, and you can get devotion unto the lotus feet of Krishna. Like the Acharya who is established in Gyan Marga, that is Shankaracharya, who is the manifestation of Shankar. So he is telling that this material world is like an ocean. So Shankaracharya is telling that material world is like ocean, and in this material ocean we are all drowning. So if we will take association of bona fide sadhus and will try to associate that sadhu for some time, then the sadhu will help us cross this material ocean like a boat. So then Kapil Dev told to Mother Devahuti that you try to associate sadhu, and it is sure that by association of a sadhu you will be able to receive the mercy of Supreme Lord. And then Mother Devahuti replied, As I am in the woman, as I am a woman, and I don't know who is a bona fide sadhu or who is a real sadhu, who is not a real sadhu. How will I be able to understand the true sadhu? As I have also not heard scriptures or read scriptures. But if you will tell me the qualities of a sadhu, or how should I recognize that I have come to a true sadhu? If you will tell me how to recognize a true sadhu, I will surely try to follow that. So then Kapildev telling to mother, first is titikshava, means tolerant. So Maharaj is giving example that so Maharaj is telling for the first quality of a sadhu should be tolerant. And Maharaj is giving example like now, if a person who is tolerant, if something very exciting thing happens, he will not start jumping, or if he will lose thumping, or if he will lose something, he will not start to cry. So he will neither get he will never get attracted to the material happiness or sadness of this world. He will stay tolerant. So Maharaj is giving example like at all the time he will be neutral. So Maharaj is giving example of Akinchana Krishnadas Babaji Maharaj. Maharaj is telling that I have seen Akinchana Krishnadas Babaji Maharaj several times. When he would come to our Sri Chaitanya Gauriya Math in Calcutta, also at the time of summer, he would carry a torn quilt on his shoulder. Also at the time of winter, a torn quilt. And he was only wearing dhoti up to his knee. And he would never get... And he was like Samadarshi. He would see everything and everyone as equal. And he was always chanting the holy name of the Lord. We have never seen him slipping. Always he is sitting in front of the temple and chanting Harinam. And he was not having any other luggage or anything. Just a dhoti which he was wearing and just a quilt he was carrying. That was his luggage and nothing else. So this is called a sadhu who is tolerant. আর কারুণিকা মানে এই এখন যেটা বলছেন কারুণিকা and the second quality of a sadhu is karunika means merciful. Means a monk who is always very merciful. So when means a sadhu who himself is serving Supreme Lord, when he see others in distress, he always showers his mercy by to those jivas by telling that please chant Harinam, please try to serve the Lord. So this is the called jivedaya, showing mercy towards the jivas. But the people of this material world are from morning till night working very hard, earning money for their own self, taking care of the family. And they are so busy in working that they don't have time to think about Supreme Lord. So the sadhu shows mercy to all these people. The sadhu himself is chanting the holy name of the Lord and also telling others to chant as well. So this is called mercy. The sadhu is mercifully helping others when he sees the people in distress by telling them to serve Lord.
Mm-hmm.
দেহ ধারণ করে, দেবতা থেকে আর একেবারে আমাদের এই যে চর যে ছোট্ট ছোট্ট যে পিপিলিকা আগে ভাইরাসও বলা যায়, বড় আক্রান্ত আছে, এগুলো কেউ তাদের কি হয় সমদর্শীন হয় না।
So the third is Samadarshi, means he sees everyone as equal. He sees a person, an elephant, even a virus, an atomic particle as the parts and parcels of Krishna. He thinks that everyone has emanated from Krishna, and in everybody's heart is reciting Supreme Lord in the form of Paramatma, and he has no enemy. He is not envious to anyone. So whatever kinds of bodies he sees in front of him, he considers everyone and everything to be parts and parcel of Krishna. Also, Supreme Lord has mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, a Pandit, whom you can call a Pandit. You cannot say the people who are teaching in the college, the professors, or the person who is teaching in your school, you cannot call them Pandit. A person who has vast knowledge in Vedic scriptures, he can be called a Pandit. But a person who has read the books of this world and has vast knowledge in the books, material books of this world, you cannot call that person to be a Pandit. And the fourth is that sadhu will have no enemy. He will not have any friends, nor he will have any enemy. He will always see everyone as his equal. And he has no enemy. So, Maharaj is giving example, like Yudhishthir Maharaj was called Ajatashatru, means Yudhishthir Maharaj was not having any enemy. Because Maharaj Yudhishthir was not having any enemy. Like Bhishma, also Bhishma has no friends nor he has any enemy. After 9 days of Kurukshetra war, Vishwa will not die because he can die when he wants. Mane yer shoinno, Yudhishthir er shoinno. So Yudhishthir thought that every day Bhishma is killing 1 lakh of our warriors every day in the war. Then Yudhishthir became very upset and sad too. Until and unless Bhishma Dev will hold the arrow in his hand, then nobody will be able to kill him. So in the 9 days of war at Kurukshetra, 9 lakhs of Yudhishthir Maharaj warriors left their bodies. And these Pandavas, they are all surrendered to Sri Krishna, and they would only take instruction and advice from Krishna only. So Yudhishthir Maharaj asked Krishna that in 9 days of war at Kurukshetra, already I lost 9 lakhs of my warriors. And I don't know when Bhishma Dev will die. So even though we are fighting with the Kauravas, but at the end of the day, we will lose the war. Already I lost 9 lakhs of my soldiers. So I think it's better we should give up and we should go somewhere else in the forest. Because it is not good that we are so many lives of the warriors have already been taken. So more people die, I don't want this. So it's better we should stop the war. So like this, Yudhishthir Maharaj told to Krishna. Krishna knows everything as he is the supreme knower, but as he is performing the pastime of a human being here, so he has to act like that. So then Krishna told to Yudhishthir Maharaj, okay, if you think that your warriors have lost their lives, so let's go to Vishwa and ask.
ভিষকে তখন জিনিসে বলছে প্রভু হে পিতামহ আপনি জানেন 9 দিন যুদ্ধ করলো আমার 9 লক্ষ সৈন্য মারা গেল
সো দে বোথ ওয়েন্ট টু ভীষ্মদেব
আর আপনার তো কোনোদিন ইচ্ছা না করলে আপনাকে মারবার কেউ ক্ষমতা নেই
সো নাও Yudhishthira is telling to Bhishmadev that already in 9 days of war, 9 lakhs of soldiers lost their lives. But so, until and unless you will be here, nobody can kill you because you can only die when you want. So then Yudhishthira Maharaj saying that it's not good to take lives of so many people. So the Maharaj is saying this is Samadarshi, means he sees everyone as equal. So he's telling it is not good to take lives of all these innocent people. Then Bhishma Dev replied, So Bhishmadev told, Bhishmadev replied that when I will have the weapon in my hand and the people of these 3 worlds in one side, including the demigods and goddesses, still no one will be able to kill me. So there is no one who can kill me. Then Yudhishthira Maharaj replied, then we should go back to forest because we don't want to do this war anymore where so many lives of the people are going every day. But Bhishmadev said that of course you will win the war. The Pandavas, so Bhishmadev said that of course the Pandavas will win the war because you have Krishna with you. Even thousands of Bhishmas will come and fight with these Pandavas, but nobody can defeat the Pandavas because Krishna is with you. But till the time I will have weapon in my hand, nobody can kill me. But 2 things I am telling you. Those who are young and doesn't know properly how to fight, I don't fight with them. And those who are not Kshatriyas, those who are not powerful people, with them I don't fight. Because it will bring a bad name to me. And I don't fight with women as well. I will never take weapon in my hand if I see any women in front of me. So thinking all this, what I told you, you try to fight with me. Then Krishna said, okay, Yudhishthira Maharaj, let's move from here. So while going back, Yudhishthira Maharaj asked Krishna, Prabhu, what's the... Bhishma didn't say that I will die or I will not do the war. So I don't understand why do we even went to him, for what reason, when we didn't get any proper answer from him. Then Krishna replied, he already told what he told, Yudhishthira Maharaj asking, that he will not fight with someone who is young, and the one who has left weapons and have run away, he will not fight with them. And those who are not powerful, with them he won't fight. He said these 3 things. And another thing he said, that the one who has taken birth as women, he will not fight with them. So these 4 things Bhishmadev already told. Krishna then telling to Yudhishthira Maharaj, then easily we can kill him. If these things we try to follow, then when he will not hold this his weapon, when these 4 things will happen, then easily we can kill him. Arjun.
Arjuna.
বিরাট রাজার ছেলে, দ্য সান অফ বিরাট রাজা।
ওস দৃষ্ট কেতু অর
দৃষ্ট কেতু?
হ্যাঁ
দৃষ্ট কেতু।
লোকে বলে না যে যুধিষ্ঠির অর্জুনের এই কৃষ্ণের সেই দিনে সেনাপতি পাতল ওই যে বিপ্রদাসের নপুং মেয়ে হয়ে জন্ম হয়েছে
বৃহন্নলা।
হ্যাঁ
নপুংসক, দ্যাটস ট্রান্সজেন্ডার।
Wasn't that Arjuna for a while though?
Brihannala.
No, Brihannala. Brihannala is Dibudi.
Oh.
Shrikhandi.
Shrikhandi. See, his memory is so strong than ours.
Today, Shrikhandi ke karuti karo. Hai, Senapati. Senapati joke Senapati juddho hai. Okay, Senapati ka
pata. Senapati mane?
Commander.
Oh. So Shrikhandi was born, Shrikhandi. So Shrikhandi was born as a woman. And Shrikhandi is he is not that powerful that his weapon will even touch the body of Bhishma Dev. And so the plan was to keep Shrikhandi in the front and Arjuna will stand behind Shrikhandi and from behind Arjuna will throw the weapon to Bhishma Dev. That was the plan. Shrikhandi. So now today it was announced in the war that today Shrikhandi. So today it was announced in the ground before the war that today the commander of Pandava side will be Shrikhandi. And they know very well that Bhishma Dev will of course not fight with someone who is a woman. Because before he told that I will not take weapon in my hand if I see a person who is less powerful, who is not powerful as him and who is young. And those who have left weapons and ran away from the ground and in front of women, he will not hold any weapon. And Shrikhandi was completely not that powerful that he will fight with all those strong warriors of the Kauravas. Behind Shrikhandi, Arjuna was standing. So from behind, Arjuna was killing the opposite party. And when all the other warriors came and they got defeated by Arjuna and when Bhishma's chariot came near, when Bhishma saw Shrikhandi standing, immediately he threw the weapon. And whatever weapon Shrikhandi was throwing, it was not even touching the body of Bhishma. So, when Bhishma Dev saw Shrikhandi standing, he immediately threw his weapon. And then Arjuna from behind started throwing the arrows which went inside the body of Bhishma Dev. And so many arrows that later he fell from the chariot. So that's why the sadhus, they have neither friends nor enemies. So that's why Bhishma Dev was having the love he was having for the Kauravas, that same love he was having for the Pandavas. কে বললেন?
তিনি বললেন যে সেনাপতি হবে দুর্যোধন কে বলে দিয়েছে, দ্রোণাচার্য কে বলে দিয়েছে, আমাদের এই বিষ তোমরা আমার কাছে যেন যেন ওই সিগন দিয়ে না আসতে পারে তার জন্য তোমরা ব্যবস্থা করো অর্থাৎ সবাই তোমার মিলে ওকে প্রতিরোধ করো যাতে আমাকে না মারতে পারে
শিখণ্ডি
তখন ধরবো না তো তখন সে একেবারে শিখণ্ডের পিছনে অর্জুন আছে
So Maharaj is telling Bhishma Dev told this before the war started that Shrikhandi is going to be the commander of today's war. And Bhishma Dev told that to Duryodhan and Dushasan that you all should stay in front of me so that I will not hold weapon because Shrikhandi will be the commander so that Shrikhandi cannot kill me. You make sure of that and you all people fight on behalf of me. I will be the back because I will not be holding any weapon because as I told earlier, in front of any women, I will not hold any weapon. So that's why, but they didn't know. So when they were fighting with the other soldiers of the Kaurava side, they all got defeated because Arjuna from behind Shrikhandi was throwing weapon and arrows. So when Bhishma Dev came near, when he saw Shrikhandi, of course, he didn't took his weapon, but rather then Arjun started throwing arrows to Bhishma Dev, and then by his arrows he got defeated. All the arrows went inside him, and he fell from the chariot. So Maharaj is telling the day before when Krishna and Yudhishthir Maharaj went, he told all the possible all the possible things that how he can be defeated. Also the next day he told Duryodhan and Dushasan to protect him. So he is Ajatashatru, means he has neither no friends nor any enemies. So that's why Bhishma Dev, though he was fighting for the Kauravas, but still the love he was having for the Kauravas, that same love he was having for the Pandavas. So among the 12 Mahajanas, Bhishma Dev is considered one of the Mahajan. So that's why sadhus has no enemy nor friends. So he told to Krishna, to Yudhishthir Maharaj how they can kill him, and also he told to Dushasan and Duryodhan how to protect him. So both the things he told to both the parties. So Maharaj is telling sadhus are like this. They have no enemies nor no friends. So here Bhishma Dev acted as nor he is the enemy of the Pandavas nor he is friends of the Kauravas. So this is also one of the major quality of a sadhu. So this is can be called an garment of a sadhu. So these are the qualities of a sadhu. So Maharaj is telling that these various qualities are the ornament, or you can say the dress of a sadhu. So these various qualities of a sadhus are the garments of sadhu. So these are the signs where of a sadhu, by which you can understand that this is a true sadhu. And how can you understand a person as a real sadhu? The one who is sincerely and steadily serving me, means Supreme Lord. The first, this is the first sign of a bona fide sadhu is, means the one who is sincerely performing devotion and serving Supreme Lord. And he will only have firm faith in Supreme Lord. He will always think his object of worship to be superior of all. He will not think others to be superior than his object of worship. Like example Maharaj is giving, like at the time of Rasa pastime, Krishna disappeared from there. And then all the gopis were searching for him. What Krishna did? When he saw the gopis are coming towards him, then immediately he took the form of a four-handed Narayan. And when the gopis came in front of him, they saw that it's Narayan. With folded hands, they said, Om Namo Narayan, and they went to search for Krishna. They didn't think that Narayan and Krishna is non-different, but they didn't say to Narayan that, please, you are our Krishna only. But they didn't show anything else. Just they, with folded hands, said Namo Narayana and went to search for Krishna. But when Radharani came in front of Krishna, his two hands went inside him. He could not hold his form, that Narayana form, in front of Srimati Radharani. So Maharaj is telling, in front of Ananya Bhakti. Ananya
Bhakti is unalloyed devotion.
Yeah, unalloyed.
Or one-pointed.
Yeah.
One-pointed.
When you have one-pointed unalloyed devotion, what happens? You cannot, means the object of worship cannot keep his other form. Like Maharaj gave an example of Srimati Radharani. When the gopis came, he was standing as Narayan. But when Srimati Radharani came, automatically he couldn't keep his Narayan form. He again came back to the form of Shyamsundar. So the devotion of Radharani is one-pointed. That is called Ananya Bhakti. Another example Maharaj is giving of Hanuman. He is the... He is, he has firm faith on Ramachandra. And he is steady in that. He have no respect for any other than Sri Ramchandra. He considers his Lord Ramchandra to be the topmost of all. Gorur. কৃষ্ণ বলছে আচ্ছা কে বলছে রামচন্দ্রই বলছে
ভগবান বলছে আচ্ছা নারায়ণ
সো নারায়ণ ইজ টেলিং টু গরুড়া দ্যাট প্লিজ গো অ্যান্ড কল হনুমান অ্যান্ড টেল হিম দ্যাট হিজ লর্ড ইজ কলিং হিম
খালি রাম বললেই হবে না রাম বললে হনুমান আসবে না কেন রাম তিনজন আছে পুরুষ রাম বলরাম আর দশরথ নন্দন রাম
So then Narayan telling to Garuda, if you will just go and tell to Hanuman that Ramchandra is calling, he will not come. Because Ram has three meanings. One is Pratham Ram, ta ki bollen?
Balaram.
First is Ram means Balaram. Then second is Purusharam,
Parashuram,
and third is Dasharath Nandan Ram. So Narayan told that to Garuda that when you will go, you should specify that you are that Dasharath Nandan Ram is calling Hanuman. So when Garuda reached to Hanuman, Hanuman and told that Ramchandra is calling you, then Hanuman replied, which Ram is calling me? Then he said that Dasharath Nandan Ram is calling you. So then immediately Hanuman woke up and said, yes, I am immediately going, and immediately he left. And if any other Ram other than Dasharath Nandan is calling, Hanuman will never reply. So Maharaj is telling here that the one who has one-pointed service, service to the one who has one-pointed devotion unto the lotus feet of Vrajendranandan Krishna, then they will not get deviated to any other forms of the Supreme Lord. Like if Nrisimha, Varaha, Kurma are there, they will not get attracted to any of other manifestations of the Lord. They will only get attracted to the lotus feet of Vrajendranandan Krishna. And whatever actions he is doing, whatever services he is performing, he is doing for the service of the Lord, for the Lord's satisfaction. Whether he is doing things according to scriptures or if he is doing non-scriptural things, but he is doing that for the satisfaction of his Lord. So that's why you have to surrender yourself unto the lotus feet of the Lord completely. Like Maharaj is giving example, when Hanuman was fighting with Ravana, it's considered to be a sin, the one who is putting fire in someone else's houses. So it is considered to be a crime. There are various kinds of sins. The first is the one who are putting fires into someone else's house, and the one who is giving poison to others. You should kill an animal or anything, but you should not give any insect or any animals any poison. It's an offense, a crime or a sin. Third is, you are not holding any weapon and you just went away and you just went towards that person and with your weapon you killed him. So that's why when two persons are fighting with a weapon, when one weapon is falling from the person's hand, the other person stops. So that's why when the other person in front of you is not holding any weapon, and if you have a weapon and if you go and kill him, that is also a sin. And the fourth is khetra, means like you are, unnecessarily you are taking somebody's land, you are taking away somebody's land forcefully. And the fifth is kidnapping other's wife. So these are the various sins. Oi je Hanuman Ravaner sathe jhamela korchilo. So when Hanuman was fighting with Ravana, he put fire to the entire kingdom of Ravana. So there were many houses in that kingdom where many cows, many innocent people were there. Even pregnant women were there. So many children were there. So all were dead. So Maharaj is telling, when at the time of when a fighting is going on, a person who is surrendered to you, don't want to fight, he's surrendering to you before the war that he don't want to fight, please leave me. So when a person is going in that mood in front of you, what Hanuman was doing, when those demons were coming in front of Hanuman and was surrendering themselves unto his feet and saying, asking for forgiveness, Hanuman would put his leg on their head and would kill them like that. Smash their head with his leg.
Mohilara
So when there was fire into the houses in the Ravana's kingdom, the innocent women, what they did to save themselves, they would jump into the pond and was waiting inside the pond to save their life. And then Hanuman would go inside, I mean, on the pond and would put fire on their hair with his tail. Though those women, they were staying in the kingdom of Ravana, but they did not do anything. But still Hanuman destroyed the entire kingdom of Ravana. And also it is written in the scriptures that you should not fight with the children or a young boy. There were grandchildren of Ravan. His name is Ahiravan. And he was inside the womb of his mother. He was not yet born, the grandson of Ravana. And Hanuman kicked in her womb, actually kicked on her womb. And the baby came out, the grandson of Ravana came out. And after the baby came out from the womb of his mother, the baby started to fight with Hanuman because they all belongs to the kingdom of a demon. Because the boy came out immediately, so he was having all the blood and other things, so Hanuman could not catch him. He was so slippery. Whenever Hanuman was trying to hold him, the boy was going out from his reach. Hanuman's pita ke dakhlo. Oh, so Hanuman was unable to fight with that small boy. So then he remembered his father, called his father, Pavandev. And his father came and put all the dust on the body of the small boy. Because when the dust all came on the body of the small boy, then Hanuman could easily catch him. And then Hanuman threw him on the ground and the boy was dead. So this is all the heinous crime. First of all, Hanuman kicked on the womb of the mother and the mother was dead and the boy came out. And Hanuman is so powerful in front of that infant, but still he killed him. So Maharaj is saying these all the actions which Hanuman did when he was fighting with Ravana, killing the innocent people, killing the women, killing the pregnant women. These are all the heinous crime he has done. And now Ravan is, nobody can defeat Ravan. And then Ram asked Vibhishan that how can I kill Ravan? Then Vibhishan replied, only Brahma has given a weapon to Ravana. And where Ravan has kept, I don't know, Vibhishan told. Nobody can kill Ravana without that weapon. So only Ravana knows where he has kept that weapon, and his wife Mandadari, she knows. And I also don't know where he has kept. And with that particular weapon which he got as a blessing from Brahma, nobody can kill him. And then Ram ordered Hanuman that you should search for that weapon. And nobody knows where he has kept. Then Hanuman immediately took the came in a form of a disguise, Brahmin. And he, like in a disguise, he came of an old Brahmin. So he took an almanac under his shoulder and was holding a stick. and went inside the room of Ravan. And the security guards of Ravana was there outside his room. And now as he is a Brahman, because nobody can stop a Brahman from doing anything. And then as he was in the disguise of an old Brahmin, he started uttering the name of Ravan in a loud voice. Oh, the king of Lanka, Ravan ki jai. Like this, he started shouting. And Mandadari, the wife of Ravana, was surprised that nobody says victory of Ravana. And she was so happy that somebody is saying jai of Ravan. See, she was very surprised. Because she thought that usually no one gives jaya of Ravan. So she was surprised. So she happily gave asan to that old Brahmin for sitting. So now she is asking, what can I do for you? Then the old Brahmin, who is Hanuman, he is telling that to the wife of Ravan, to Mandadari, Hanuman is telling that nobody can defeat your husband, Ravan. He is the strongest man on this earth. Forget about Ramachandra. He is an ordinary human being. What he can do? He is the son of Dasharath. What he can do to Ravan? Ravan is the king of...
Conqueror?
Huh? Conqueror?
Conqueror. He's conqueror.
Oh yeah, he is the conqueror of the three worlds. So then Hanuman is telling to Mandadari, only you can kill Ravana. To wife of Ravana, he is telling. Hanuman, who is in the form of a Brahmin, he is telling to Mandadari that you can only kill Ravan. So he is telling that if you don't be cautious, then Ravan has to leave his body, and that is by also your hand. Because the special weapon is there with you only, and by that only you can kill Ravana. Because he heard that from Vivishan, that only there is a special weapon given to Ravana by Brahma, and by that only he can be killed. So now the Brahmin, Hanuman, who is in the disguise of Brahman, telling to Mandadari, you should keep that weapon very safely. Otherwise, if you keep it in a very known place, then these monkeys which will come from the group of Ramchandra, they will come and take away. And easily, they can kill Ravan. So you keep that special weapon very safely. And then Mandadari, with folded hands, replying to the old Brahmin, that I have kept that weapon very safely. Nobody will know where I have kept it. Then the Brahmin said that you are a woman. I cannot trust you where you have kept. Because the woman, they don't have brains. And I cannot trust that where you have kept it. So I cannot trust you. And then she said, no, please trust me, and I am telling you where I have kept. Just behind this thumb, I have kept that weapon hidden. So as I have kept this special weapon inside this thumb, nobody will know about it. So he said, okay, is it safe there? She said, yes, it's safe here. And then immediately he came in his real form as a Hanuman and punched inside the thumb and took out the weapon. And then Mandadari was stunned to see what just happened, and she said, "Such a idiot person you are, you foolish, you just came to me in a disguise of a Brahmin, and you means you stole my special weapon." And she got so furious. "You told a lie, and you so you have committed a heinous sin by telling lie to me, because I told you where I have kept the weapon." Then Hanuman is telling, "I can do everything for my lord Ramchandra." So that's why in the shlokas it is written, whatever work he has done, whatever activities he has done in Lanka, Hanuman, those sins are the most heinous sins he has committed. But he has done nothing for his own satisfaction. He has done everything for the satisfaction of Lord. So whatever you are doing, whether it's a good or whether it's a bad, you should do everything for the satisfaction of the Lord. In Ramayana also, and also in Srimad Bhagavatam, it is written that even if you do wrong activities for the satisfaction of Supreme Lord or for Supreme Lord, then it will be considered as a true work. So, but for your satisfaction, if you're doing religiosity or religious activities for your satisfaction, then it will be a sin. But if you're doing wrong activities also, that is, if you know you're doing it wrong, but if you're doing it for the service or for the satisfaction of the Lord, that will be service. Because that Supreme Lord is all powerful, he can destroy all sins. So though Hanuman here killed so many innocent people, the pregnant woman, the cows, so many things he has done, and all those sins are the heinous sins he has done, but he has not done anything for his own satisfaction, but everything he has done for the satisfaction of the Lord. That's why none of his sins has been considered as a heinous sin, because that is, whatever he has done for his Lord, for Lord Ramchandra. Okay, so Maharaj is saying that he will stop here. Tomorrow again we will continue. I hope everyone understood. So you should do everything keeping Krishna as the center. Then everything will be considered as bhakti, devotion. But even though you are doing anything for your satisfaction, even that is a religious work, but then that will be considered a sin. Because in that religious work which you are doing, there your satisfaction lies there, not you are doing for the satisfaction of the Lord. Because Supreme Lord is like a CCTV camera. He is seeing everything that you are doing for your own self or for him, or for him you are doing. So Maharaj is telling that the question which you asked, do you have that mood now? Mane kon bhavta?
Aje matar
kore. That which you told, what was happening with you?
Aje matar kore.
Yeah.
Oi bhavta ache ki na?
So are you still having that same thing? Ha ha. Ache.
Ojen tumi dhore ega dhire dhire.
So Maharaj is telling, though you have this, you try to keep this inside you, because this will take you only to Supreme Lord. So Maharaj is telling what he told, that you have to chant Harinam slowly and with proper pronunciation. Maharaj is telling, this which you are having, this present condition, this is good. So he is telling, you should try to keep it with yourself by chanting Harinam. And Maharaj is telling, that's why Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur has said chanting of 64 rounds every day. What is like 1 lakh chanting of Harinam, what it means? 1 lakh has two meaning. One means counting of 1 lakh, and another is with one-pointed devotion. Yes, means with your mind, speech and body, you have to like with one-pointed devotion. So Maharaj is telling that there are two meanings. One is counting of 1 lakh names and another is with one-pointed. So some people, they try to focus on chanting 1 lakh of name. They focus on the rounds. So if your focus is to complete 1 lakh, means 1 lakh name, means 64 rounds. So Maharaj is telling, if you're focusing on 64 rounds, then you are thinking that when I will finish. But if you are chanting with one-pointed sincerity, with sincerity and with one-pointed aim, that of chanting Harinam, means even though you are chanting one round, and that should be a quality chanting, because that time you are focused in the quality, you are not focused that I have to finish 64 rounds. Because when you are, your focus is 64 rounds, you are running after the focus, but that time you are not chanting quality rounds. But when you are chanting slowly and very sincerely, that time you are actually chanting. So that's why Maharaj is telling, rather than focusing on the number of rounds, you should focus on the quality of chanting. Even though you are chanting 2 rounds, but it should be quality chanting with your mind, with full concentration and sincerity, where your mind is only in Harinam and in nothing else. Okay, so I hope everyone has understood what Maharaj wants to say. So today he will stop here. Tomorrow he will again speak at same time. Okay. Hare Krishna. So tomorrow he will again speak. So today he spoke about the qualities, or the how can you understand who is a true sadhu. These are the signs you can see inside a true sadhu. So tomorrow he will speak on association of a sadhu. So these are the qualities when you see inside a sadhu, then when you will associate seeing these qualities inside the sadhu, then your association will be successful. So these are the various qualities of a sadhu. So now we are discussing. So you have to associate with this kind of sadhus, those who holds these qualities. So in Srimad Bhagavatam it is also written, those who have associated with this kind of sadhus, what fruits they received. What happened to those people or to those devotees, those who have associated this kind of sadhus, those who have these qualities. So now we are discussing about the various qualities of a sadhu. And by associating with these sadhus, what we will get, tomorrow we will discuss about this. Okay. Hare Krishna. Dandavat pranam to all. Maharaj is saying that Supreme Lord is our rescuer and He is our protector. So don't think of anything else and you should chant Harinam. Hare Krishna.